prepare our hearts for the message.
Metro South message.
Come on up and preach the word. We're going to sing hallelujah. Yeah. Lord, we sing your praises loud. Sing unto the stumbling crowd. Sing of Jesus and his word. Sing until the earth has heard.
My 21 years of being a Christian, I've never heard that song.
Yeah.
Where I did. What was the name of that song, by the way? Not the last one we did, but the one before that. Given, it'll come back to you? Oh, that's a great song, man. Okay, the theme today is entitled The Courage of Christ, right? We saw that little video of Man of Steel. I want to appreciate Larry doing the offering for us this morning. Amen. That's awesome. I appreciate Pablo doing communion. Now, many of you don't know, but Pablo, he's been going through some health challenges. And he wasn't sure he was able to do it this morning, but he pushed through, man. And I appreciate that example. Amen. I believe that took courage to do that. Yesterday, we played in the Copa de la Vida LA Church soccer tournament. Amen. Awesome. We got murdered here, man. But it was a great time of play. I see John just laughing over it. Yeah, it didn't quite go our way. But I do want to say I'm very encouraged by our turnout of it, the guys who came out to it. And we need more guys for next year, guys. That's basically what it came down to, okay? By the end of the first half, we were pretty gassed out there. You know, it was kind of a rough transition for us. But hey, we hung out there. We violated all the rules in it of the tournament, but ended up being a great time. We weren't trying to, but we needed to just to, you know, we talked to the different coaches there, but hopefully we can be a part of that next year. And one of the guys already on our team, Carlos from the Metro East group, was like, hey, how about we start practice for next year's Copa de la Vida in June 2014. Next week, we're thinking of starting practice. So, but man, the talent there was great. You know, Mike was out, different guys were out there. Mike plays college soccer, okay? And even he was impressed out there, but you know, he was showing his groove to everybody out there. And he was representing us very, very well. I do want to really appreciate the guys who kind of stepped in and just tried to run. like Chris Anguiano, he's back there. Chris, you saw her today? You saw her today? Oscar, his brother, and then Jose Anguiano came out kind of last minute. And then Gustavo was up. Guys, Gustavo was so tired in it. You know, they were like, hey, do we have any subs? I was like, bro, there's no subs today, man. You just gotta stay. I'm like, Gustavo, get that guy. Gustavo's just looking. You know how, like, you're so tired, he's just looking at me, but he's looking past me, you know? I'm like, Gustavo, we gotta run after that guy. He just said, he couldn't even move anymore, man. And, it was just one of those days, you know, where it was a rough day. But he was out there, amen? He was out there. A couple of our guys were sick because of all the running that involved in it. But man, the talent level in the church, guys, was phenomenal, you know? I'm not even sure. We're already out of the tournament after the first day. But I think all of us on our team was probably like, thank God we're out of the tournament. We're so out of shape, you know? So, amen, man. We'll do better next year, okay? And we'll get more of your support to pray for us next year as we need more strength from God. Okay, Acts chapter 4, verse 1.
All right.
As we talk about the courage of Christ this morning, I want you to think about your own courage for a minute. Okay? What would you do to have to be courageous? Amen? In Acts chapter 4, in verse 1, it says, the priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, and the number of men grew to about 5,000. I mean, that's courageous, right? That's perhaps a type of Christianity that we may not always be familiar with, where people, because they preach about Jesus, are put in jail because of that. Now, there could be a tendency when you look at this passage to think, hey, you know what? If we preach Jesus and jail is the thing that's going to be coming down the path for us, right, how many of us might stop preaching, right? Yeah. Because it takes courage to do that, knowing that if you preach the word, you might go to jail for that. It'd be interesting how many of us would respond this morning if cops just came in and just took me and Bruce away.
Woohoo! No, I'm just kidding.
That would be crazy, right? But yeah. How many of us might have had a thought, I wonder why the cops came in to take him away? You might have thought that. Is there something they're not telling us still? Something like that, right? But imagine this. This took courage for them to do that, okay? To be jailed for their faith. And when you think about the motivation, jump with me down. You go, what was their motivation in this? What made these guys learn to preach about Jesus and be jailed for their faith? You know, what was the motivation in verse 12? Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. You know, one of the things that was cool, what gave them courage, it wasn't their education, it wasn't their training, it wasn't their abilities that gave them the courage. It was the time spent with Jesus that made them courageous. Yes. So if you want to be a courageous person for God, the issue isn't how much training, ability, or even schooling you have. The issue is, how much time will you spend with Jesus? And you know, when it's like that, anybody can do that, right? You don't have to feel bad if you didn't get a degree or didn't get that, or you don't have all this type of training in the world, because the amount of time you spend with Jesus is directly proportional to the amount of courage that you end up having. And so anybody can do that, right? And I like that stuff, you know, because I respect people. I respect Christians because it takes great courage to live like Christ.
Yeah.
It really does. If you're not living like Christ, it doesn't take much courage to do that. Yeah. It takes courage, though, to live in year after year, day after day, month after month, about being a disciple and living like the Bible. Well, you go, Rhys, right now, you're catching me at a time where, man, I haven't been very courageous. That may be true, you know. Some of us in here might be feeling like, man, I'm on a down slope right now. I've been kind of in a low in my faith, and I haven't been the most courageous lately. It's okay. A lot of times when you're on the downside spiritually, it's because you have been giving so much for so many years. That's why. And you need a little break to recover. You know, take the time that you need to recover. Amen. Just don't take too long where you don't ever recover. You know how it is? It's like if you're trying to lose weight, you're like, oh, tomorrow we'll start. You know what? I just ate a cheesecake out there today, guys. And I was literally like, you know what, tomorrow? I'll work out tomorrow. I was helping the singles out with their special out there. I saw that cheesecake. I didn't have breakfast this morning. They asked me, and I thought, you know, I probably need to eat that cheesecake to give me some encouragement before I get up to speak today. And so I ate. But really, I just talked to my wife just the other day about, hey, babe, let's get on top of, you know, working out again. Let's get on top of, you know, losing weight, working out, just getting fit spiritually as well as physically, right? And here I am eating a cheesecake Sunday morning. But it was really good cheesecake. You know, I believe it took courage for me to do that, to eat that cheesecake. Matthew 16.
Amen. Come on, man.
Here's a great passage I want you to consider this morning.
All right.
How do you feel? And give me your honest opinion, okay? How do you feel when someone tells you, Greg, you must do that? How do you feel when someone says that, Greg? If someone tells you, it's not that I'm asking you to do it, you must do this.
Compelling.
My sinful nature would probably say, I'm not going to do it. You told me I must.
Yeah, you had me until the must that was there, right?
Must.
Exactly. Okay, anybody else? How does it feel when somebody tells you you must do this? Do most of us go, oh, I'm very encouraged by that. You know, you must give me your money. You out your mind, bro. Get out of here. Okay, but most of us probably have a sense of rebellion, right? If somebody tells you you must do this, our normal response usually is, well, why don't you do it first? And then I'll decide whether I'd like to do it. But I want to show you a passage. In Matthew 16, in verse 21, okay, it says, from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Now, we all know that ain't a good thing to do, guys. Don't rebuke Jesus. Never, Lord, he said. This shall never happen to you. Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone would come after me, he might deny himself. Does your Bible say that?
No.
When it's the most appropriate time, he should deny himself. When it's convenient for yourself, you should deny yourself. He must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Whoever wants to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for me will find it. What good will it be for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what he has done. I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Mm. I mean, what a passage, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Jesus could have done many other things than just die. Like perhaps more miracles, right? He could have fed 10,000 the next time, or healed many more people with ailments, raised more people from the dead, or even walk on water in front of thousands of people. Or make more money come out of a fish. He could have done so many different things. But it says here that Jesus said he must go to Jerusalem and die. Right? That he chose to do the must do. Now it's amazing. You know, when you become a disciple, you start studying the Bible first. And then you start learning about like a must do list that God has. That we're not aware of until we actually start studying the Bible. Usually we have our own must-do list, right? Man, I must make more money. I must marry this person. I must get the house of my dreams. I must do all have everything I need for my kids. We call that the necessities in life, right? These are the things that must happen in our lives, right? But Christ does something a little different. He goes, what I must do is die for us. That's the must-do list in him. And it's funny. We don't ever get to see God's must-do list until we become Christians. And then he counts on us to do what must be done for him.
Amen.
And that must-do list is what I want to talk about this morning. Amen. And it takes courage to do this list, guys. It takes courage because it's the same courage Christ did. He would never ask us to do something he wouldn't do himself, right? And so when you look at this today, I want you to be thinking about the courage of Christ, what it took. But I'm going to give you some practicals in it on what we must learn to do as well. Amen?
Amen.
So go with me to Mark chapter 9. Right. And we'll dive right in. And the first
one. Right,
it's funny, you know, guys, because in, you know, kids, they need to have boundaries. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Oh, children yeah. with no boundaries, what happens to the children?
S-P-O-R-L-E-D.
They become wild, disrespectful, they go crazy, right? But it's funny how when you have a child that has gone crazy for a little bit and has been didn't have boundaries for a period of time, and then you put them within a set of boundaries, it's amazing how the child blossoms in that process.
Yeah.
That because kids want to be respectful, they want to be obedient, mm-hmm. they want to be selfless even and even respectful to their parents, mm-hmm. but they don't always know what it looks like though. Mm-hmm. And so when we ask our kids to be respectful, we're disrespectful to them. How will they ever learn how to be respectful?
Right.
You know, you can't, you know, it's the principle of sowing and reaping. If you plant an apple seed, what kind of tree will you get?
An apple tree.
It's impossible for you to get an orange tree
or
if you plant an apple seed. And so one of the things we're going to be talking about is the boundaries to which God kind of puts out there for us so we can live within. And if you live within these boundaries, it's amazing how quickly we blossom spiritually. Because this is the same boundaries that was set for Christ and he lived on. In Mark chapter 9, the first one in verse 33.
Mark, what chapter?
They came to...
9:33.
Let me see here.
Come on, Rhys.
Oh, yeah. In verse 33, as they came to Capernaum, when he was in the house, he asked them, what were you arguing about on the road? But they kept quiet because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest. Isn't that amazing how when the guys were with Jesus, one of the things they were always arguing about is who gets to be the greatest? And what's the answer? Nobody does. Christ gets to be the greatest, right? But you can still be great also though. And he teaches us how to be great. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, if anyone wants to be first, he must be the very last and the servant of all. Notice what it says. If anyone wants to be first, he must be the very last. The first point I want to talk about is this. Is we must be last and we must serve. Because that's how Christ did, right? He was last and he served. And so we must learn to do that as well. Amen. Now let me ask the guys who are in the soccer mic, since you're right up here in the front row. Yesterday, how were you praying to be last in the tournament? Was it even a thought you had? Were you like, man, I pray Metro LA comes in last so we can share with our whole sector how last of a place we came in? Nobody does that, right? It's so opposite of the thinking. At work, do you want to be last at work? When it comes to job, a new career, new job openings, do you want to be last in that line? Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, most of us want to be first. And you're taught from a very young age to be
first.
And yet, that's what's so amazing about Christ is, as we're working our way up the corporate ladder, he's working his way down the ladder to be last. Mm-hmm. And because he's last, he becomes a servant of all, and it becomes the greatest. And you know, so the first point is we must be last and we must serve. Amen. Because Jesus said the greatest honor we can have is to serve. And you know, for the most part, Christians really believe this, right? All of us want to serve.
Yeah. Yeah.
I really agree. I really believe that. Most people feel it's an honor to serve. You know, and you've probably been doing it for years. Mm-hmm. The challenge is with serving is what we in the psychological in the psychological world, they call it serving fatigue. You know what serving fatigue is? Is that you've served for so long, you just have nothing left to give. Anybody felt like that before? Mm-hmm. And you can be a Christian a long time. Sometimes Christians are the most unhappiest people because they have serving fatigue. You know, they've been serving for so long and they feel like they're being a bad Christian. You're not. You just have serving fatigue. And you got to learn to renew yourself over and over again. Just like in marriage, right? You can love your spouse. You can love your spouse but be out of love at the same time. Like, you're out of love, but you're not in love. You know what I mean by that? And spouses, this happens in marriages. The longer you get in a marriage, it's easy to... We all know we love our spouses. But being and living in love is a whole different story.
Yep.
Does that make sense? Yep. See how quiet we are in the room right now? I think some of us got that going on right now. I've had it for years with me and Grace, you know? We're a lot more fired up about our marriage right now, partly because we've been kind of getting renewed being in L.A. and just, you know, spending time with you, getting discipling, and learning how to serve again, learning how to serve one another. And guys, it serving is... It's best when it's done when it doesn't benefit you. That's the point of it, right? Yeah. Yeah. If you're only serving to benefit you, that's not serving.
Right.
If it benefits others, it's serving.
Yeah.
And we're supposed to be last and learn to serve. Here's some signs to know that you have serving fatigue. Or you have a lack of concern for people, but a major concern for myself. Lack of concern for others, extreme concern for self. Does that make sense? Another sign is you're irritated by the people you serve. If you're serving people, you're like, oh, God, what am I doing, right? You have serving fatigue. If you're irritated by the people that you serve, you have probably serving fatigue.
Yeah.
You hear people asking others to serve, and you all of a sudden get clammy, sweaty, you start... Oh, I feel uncomfortable because you think, you know, you're praying that no one asks you to serve. You have serving fatigue. If a leader walks by you and says hi, and you think the only reason why they said hi is to get you to serve, you have serving fatigue. If John Lagarde walks by you and he says hi, and you're like, he only just wants me to serve, that's why he said hi. You have serving fatigue, guys, okay? And it does crazy things to us. And the worst place to be is a disciple who no longer likes to serve. You'll be unhappy because you weren't born to do that, that's why. Just like disciples aren't born to be selfish, right? We're made so that we can learn to be serving. And when we give our lives away, that's when Christianity becomes so fun and exciting. I want you to hear this illustration, okay, about the role of the first century church. There's a legend which tells how Jesus went back to heaven after his time on earth. Even in heaven, he bore upon him the marks of the cross. The angels were talking to him and Gabriel and said, "Master, you must have suffered terribly for men down there." "I did," said Jesus. And said Gabriel, "Do they all know about how you loved them and what you did for them?" "Oh no," said Jesus, "not yet. Just now, only a few people in Palestine know." "What have you done," said Gabriel, "to let everyone know about it?" Jesus asked. "Well, I've asked Peter, James, and John, and a few others to make it the business of their lives to tell others about me, and others still others, and yet others, until the farthest man on the widest circle knows what I have done." Gabriel looked very doubtful, for he knew well what poor stuff men were made of. "Yes," he said, "but what if Peter and James and John grow tired? What if the people who come after them forget? What if way down in the 21st century, people just don't tell others about you? Haven't you made other plans?" And Jesus answered, "I haven't made any other plans. I'm counting on them." To say that the church is the body means that Jesus is counting on us. See, the church is not just a place where disciples meet on Sunday and midweek. It's where Jesus is counting on us to serve and get his message out to the world.
Amen.
For Christ, there's no other plan. The The plan was, I'm going to love them. I'm going to serve them. And in doing so, that's enough to convince people to serve others for their lifetime. I mean, that's a deep plan, isn't it? You go, well, gosh, it doesn't seem like that's enough. It is enough. And I believe we'll get it as we go, as we stay focused on Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Luke chapter 9, verse 23.
Okay.
So the first point is we must be last and we must serve. We must learn to serve. And for the most part, guys, most of us want to serve. We do. I know we do. It's just learning how to renew your faith and getting out there, getting on the horse again if you fell off, you know? Mm-hmm. In Luke 9, 23, we know this passage when we studied about being a disciple with you.
Yeah.
Then he said to them all, if anyone would come after me, he must
deny
himself. That's another thing on the must-do list, right? Is we must learn to deny ourselves and take up his cross daily and follow. The second point is we must deny self. If you don't deny yourself, guys, you'll get consumed with self.
Yeah.
And a lot of times we're being saved from ourselves more than anything, you know? And I appreciate the guys who are in the soccer tournament. Man, I gotta tell you, that revealed so much about us, man. I tell you, sports does it all the time. It revealed a lot about our character, about how much we're ready to quit, you know, when things get tough or when they score goals on us. And, you know, when you want a sub because you're so tired. I mean, I thought Oscar was going to faint, guys, you know. Yesterday, for 12 guys, okay, and then other times somebody had to leave so there was only 11 guys. 11 guys drank 96 bottles of water yesterday. And 1 5-gallon... jug of Gatorade. That's how much they drank, guys, before they almost fainted. Okay? And I appreciate the guys denying themselves up there because they're doing it for the team. Some of the guys came last minute. Some guys dropped out. So some people came last minute to get in the get. And they, I don't think they thought it was going to be that hard, to be honest. I thought they thought, hey, we're going to play a couple soccer games. It's going to be great. But we didn't realize the soccer game lasted, you know, 35 minutes for each half. So it lasted over our 10 minutes, basically, right? And then we had another game right after. So after we were done at the first game, and I appreciate the guys, I could see it on their face. They were all like, look, dude, how about you just tell the dudes we don't have guys already. We just let them play on the field by themselves and let them feel good about themselves, you know? We'll just sit here and watch them play. We're a bit tired right now. I could see it on our faces. Nobody was asking me, bro, let's go. Let's get ready. And I was like, oh, dude, we already? We got to go in the game already? I mean, guys, the refs had to wait 5 extra minutes because we have to, like, pull guys from our team to get on the field because we couldn't get our shoes on at that time. You know what I mean? It was like one of those, okay, we're a little overwhelmed here. And I appreciate all the guys out there denying themselves. Amen?
Amen.
And it made a difference. You know who it made a difference on? It made a difference on the other team that we were playing with because they know we were outmanned. We didn't have enough gas in our tank. And, you know, like, there's all these rules in it, and you're only supposed to have one person who's visiting the church that could be on the field. We had 4. You know, you're not supposed to have anybody on your team other than Metro LA. Orange County, we had a member from Orange County on our team. We had a member from Lighthouse on our team, okay? And because we needed guys, that's why. Does that make sense? So it ended up working out like that, you know? But I appreciate all the guys denying. And guys, part of when you deny yourself, it's never convenient. When you study with people, you're always going to have things going on in your life, right? It'll always be an inconvenience to you as a Christian. That's why we have to learn to deny ourselves. I mean, if you've been a disciple for a long time, I can't imagine how many hours you've put in to serving God already. If you've been a Christian for a long time. Amen. But we got to always learn to deny ourselves. Luke chapter 4, the third thing, and we'll close out with 2 more passages. In Luke chapter 4, so these are things we must learn how to do. Amen. We got to get good at denying ourselves. Sometimes, guys, I feel like in the church, sometimes people get so mad because we're calling people to live like Jesus. You know, like when people come to midweek and they come in, they're like ready to fall asleep. I know you're tired. Deny yourself, though.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah. You can't get mad at somebody if somebody pulls us on. Like, we come in. Imagine if I was a preacher and I came in, I was like, man, I feel so discouraged today, you know, and I'm going to fire you guys up. Wouldn't you pull me on the side and go, dude, stop for a minute, okay? The door's right over there. Leave your problems at the door before you speak to us. Right?
Yeah.
Because if you get to listen to me, the least I can do is prepare and come in with a good attitude. Correct?
Right.
But if you see that, guys, we're going to learn how to teach people to deny themselves, you know? It's not. We're not doing Christ a favor by coming. He's done it for us. Does that make sense? Okay. So think about it, you know? So I bet everybody's going to come into video this week a little bit more peppy and fired up, you know? You're going to get the service, I'm tired. You know, I'm going to leave my stuff at the door right now, and I'm going to come in, and I'm going to encourage somebody. Amen? You never know what big of a difference that could make in somebody's life if we just learn the principle of denying yourself. And don't tell me you don't know how to deny yourself, because you do every day. Yeah. How many of you get up just fired up to go to work every single day? Look around the room. But you deny yourselves and go anyway, right?
Yeah.
How many of us, every day, just going, I just want to read my Bible today, man. I've been doing this for 18 years, and every day I get fired up to do it. Look around. You learn to deny yourselves and do it because you know it's right, and you know it's going to benefit ourselves. But it doesn't always feel good at the time of day. Amen? Yeah. So learn to deny yourself. Luke chapter 4, in verse 42. We're almost done.
Okay.
In verse 42 it says, at daybreak Jesus went out to a solitary place. The people were looking for him, and when they came to where he was, they tried to keep him from leaving. But he said, I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns also, because that is why I was sent. And he kept on preaching in the synagogues of Judea. One of the things about Jesus is that he came to preach the good news. Amen.
Amen.
And you know what, guys? It takes courage to preach the good news.
Yes, it
and
does.
That is what it is. Amen. The gospel is the good news.
That's right.
Yep.
But sometimes we turn it into bad news.
Yep.
Because we're not in it enough, you know, and preaching about it enough. And I tell you what, when you start preaching the good news to people, man, I'm telling you, it's amazing what happens in that process, you know, and what happens to you. Sometimes in the church, we have some bad vibes because we've talked about preaching the word to others and use certain methods to help get that result, but not have the right heart in it. Amen. Yeah. We preach the good news because that's what Jesus did. Mm-hmm. And because he loved and cared for people, we do the same. If you haven't preached the good news in a while, it's easy to forget it's the good news. Like if you're struggling in a marriage, one of the best things you could do is study with somebody else and help them in their marriage. It's amazing how things go when we look at the world and see how messed up people's lives really are and how much the good news can help them. Amen? It's amazing. At that soccer thing yesterday, a guy on our team, he's dating this girl, and they're both close to becoming Christians right now, you know? And he was like, dude, I've been with this girl for, 10 years, and I've been studying the Bible, and man, us studying the Bible about the scriptures is just changing my relationship with my girlfriend right now. They're probably going to be getting baptized this weekend, you know? And what's cool is to hear him say that, though, you know? And you know how it is, like, when guys, like, and it's kind of funny, because guys aren't always the most open about sharing about their feelings.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
We're not always the most open. A lot of us are, but some of us aren't, you know? And he was talking to me, and he was like, dude, this is awesome. You know? And I was going, well, what are you learning about? And he goes, bro, I'm just learning the Word of God. And if I do it, it changes things in my life.
Yeah.
And he looked at me like, are you doing it too? Yeah, I'm doing it too, bro. How long have you been a Christian? I've been a Christian almost as long as you've been alive. You know? And he goes, I'm like, wow, dude, how long? Like 21 years? He goes, 21 years.
Yeah.
That just made me feel so old, man. He was like, oh my gosh, 21. It almost seemed archaic, you know, that when he was talking to me. I was like, 21 years. In the big scheme, I'm just, that's not that long, right? In a lifetime. And I was so encouraged by that. You know, we're studying the Bible with a guy right now. Alex is studying the Bible. He's in the back left, back your left, back there, my back right. And he's 18 years old. And as he's been studying the Bible, one of the challenges he's been faced with in studying the Bible is there's different things that the Bible calls him to become a disciple, right? And guys, everybody has their cost.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody has a cost to become a Christian, man. It's, you know, just because, you know, salvation is free, it doesn't mean it didn't cost anything. It definitely cost something for Jesus. And we're challenged to have that as well. And what was really cool is he's been studying. Things have been going really great. And so he started to read some certain passages about loving Jesus more than anything. you know, more than myself, more than my family. And he's been going through some really, really intense persecution right now.
Right.
Intense persecution that would make most, that would make disciples just feel a bit rattled in their faith. And you know, he's been studying the Bible. It's been rough. Jim has known him for about 10 years, perhaps, since Alex was how old? 8 years old. Jim has known him from 8 years old and has a relationship with Alex for the last 10 years.
Wow.
And has been mentoring him, working with him. And he's been finally studying the Bible. He's had intense persecution, guys.
Mm-hmm.
The kind where it makes you go, wow, dude, you know, it rattles your faith. And he has been rattled to some degree, but he's been praying about it. And today he's going to become your brother in Christ.
Woo-hoo!
His baptism will take place at 3:30 at Manhattan Beach. So if you want to join him over there, you can join him in it. But it's the good news for him, you know. He comes to church fired up. It's rough, though, because he is being intensely persecuted. And we're not talking like a little bit of persecution. We're not talking like, oh, you know, I don't like you, bro, because you spoke the word to me. Not that kind of persecution. A lot more in depth. Amen. And so consider that, okay? But he's going to be your brother today. It's the good news to him. But he never really quite understood it until he started looking at scriptures that called him to be more like Jesus. And then when it calls you to be more like Jesus, you got to learn to obey and do it, even if it doesn't make you feel good. Because like a lot of times when you're sick, when you take medicine, you get worse before you get better, right?
Yeah.
It's the same way with this. As he's been living it out and dealing with it, oh my gosh, his faith has been growing tremendously. And your brother has been standing up for Christ in ways that are just so inspirational, right? I hope you will go and talk to him after this. I hope you will talk to him and encourage him in his faith. You know, just getting to service today, he was intensely persecuted. Just to be here, he was intensely persecuted this morning. Amen? So, you know, pray for him in that, you know. It reminds me of scriptures in the Bible, like where in Acts chapter 5, where people were flogged and they're put in jail, but they never stopped preaching about the good news.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? I go, that's more biblical than most things we necessarily come in contact with in the kingdom sometimes. We get out of touch that people actually make decisions that cost them something very greatly, and that it is the right thing to do.
Yeah.
Amen? So for him, it's been so powerful. Last passage in Acts chapter 9, and we'll close out right here.
Okay, Rhys.
There's so many more on the to-do list, but for time's sake, I'm going to close out, and we can get on with our day. The last thing in verse 9 is, as Saul is one of the main guys who is persecuting the church, right? The Lord works through this guy named Ananias. And in verse 15, as Saul gets converted, right? In verse 15 it says, "But the Lord said to Ananias, go, this man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." One of the things Jesus did was that he learned to suffer. And guess what we must learn to do?
Suffer
as well. I mean, imagine that being told to you. Like, hey, you know, you're going to become a Christian, and I want to show you how much you're going to have to suffer for me, man, and for my name. But suffering is great, guys, and it's bearable when it's for someone you love, isn't it?
Yeah.
Parents will suffer for their children immensely when it's for someone they love. But we rarely suffer for people we don't love. You know, we just go beat it, dude. Get out of here. We just quickly do something else. Amen? And so the last point I want to make is we must suffer. And we must learn to suffer. And I want to give you an illustration, okay, of something that I think will encourage you. Anyone who has had a child knows that giving birth takes a lot of effort. For 9 months, this child is growing inside the womb. Then the day arrives. Suddenly there is agony. You ladies just don't understand what suffering we guys have to go through. We have to be sensitive and attentive. We have to hold your hand and never let on that your grip is killing us. We have to make sure the ice chips and ice water are near. Make sure the drugs are coming. Make sure the doctors and nurses are ready, all without leaving your side. We have to remind you to breathe and to do so gently, while you are swearing that we will never have another child again. And that somehow you are blaming us guys for doing this to you. I mean, you get to lie in bed the whole time. That should tell you something. A woman once told me that if I wanted to know what giving birth was like, take my upper lip and pull it over my head. All I know is that if it were down to men giving birth to children, the human race would have died out long ago. Now, it's a funny illustration, right? And ladies, you go through so much. But you go through so much because it's for the one you love.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how women will go through childbirth. And they will go through the pains of labor. And they sometimes become a different person in that process, but come back after that. But it's amazing that immediately after that, you know, days after, women can go again, after that traumatic experience, women can go, I'm ready to have another child. Men look at that and go, I respect you so much. I respect you so much. I am really glad that I'm not a woman, man, because I don't know how I would do. I respect my wife for having three kids like that and going through that process. I don't know, guys, if I could do that. That's a rough process, man. So, ladies, you're awesome, amen? And we've got to learn how to suffer. And I use that illustration because that's how we have to suffer in God's kingdom as well, amen? You will suffer when you love, for somebody you love.
Right.
And if you love God and you love His kingdom, you'll suffer for Him because that's exactly the same thing that He's done with us, amen?
Amen.
So, as we close out today, and as you think about things, if you think about your courage, there really is a must-do list. The word must is used 786 times in the Bible.
Wow.
Where God commands us, this is what we must do. I mean, there is a must-do list in the Bible that is long, and Jesus is counting on us to see if we can have the courage to do that as well. Amen?
Amen.
I know you have the courage. If you're lacking it, the issue is not your shortcomings. The issue is spending more time with Jesus.
Yeah.
So, thank you for your time, your energy.
Thank you, sir.
Let's get out there and have the courage for Christ. Amen. Love you. Have a great day.
Thank you for listening. This is the Metro South Message at Radio ART.
Good afternoon.
How do I say goodbye to what we had? The good time that made us laugh, I'll wait them back. I thought we'd get to see forever, but forever's gone away. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday. And I'll take with me the memories to be my sunshine after the rain. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday. And I'll take